Why don't we begin tonight by singing? Let's sing Psalter number 278. 278. And let's sing the five stanzas. We open with prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, we call upon thy holy name. There is no God like thee. There is no God beside thee. A God who is triune, so that we confess that the Father is God and the Son is God and the Holy Ghost is God. And these three are one, so that thou art the covenant God in thyself. And a God who establishes and perfects and maintains thy covenant, who shows us that covenant in every area of our life, so that thou dost give us fellowship together with Jesus Christ. Thou dost give us membership in thy church, that we might have all things in common. Thou dost give unto us our homes, so that we might have our marriages, and if it pleases thee, our children, and who also gives us the good Christian school. And we pray, Lord, that thou wilt bless the cause of good Christian schools in the Reformed Protestant denomination. We love our schools because we love thy covenant. And we pray, O Lord, that thou wilt establish them in churches, so that the parents and the whole church may give themselves with a zeal to that labor and work. And wilt thou defeat and overthrow all of the opposition to the good Christian school, which manifests itself in many different ways. We ask, Lord, that thou wilt Forgive our sins. Be with us tonight as we hear about the school and use that speech to encourage thy people in this difficult and demanding labor. We ask all of these things not because we are worthy, but for Jesus' sake. Amen. I want to welcome everybody who came tonight, as well as those that are listening online. The origin of this speech was an email that I received from a concerned member of Sovereign Reformed Protestant Church asking for a lecture on the school in light of the opposition that was being faced. And that opposition came from the most curious source, the then and now former consistory of Sovereign Reformed Protestant Church. The request for this lecture precipitated the series of events that exposed the deep opposition to the Christian school in the consistory at Sovereign. And the school then, as it has been all through Reformed church history, the school also faces controversy in our churches. And it is the purpose of the speech tonight to address some of those issues. I don't have the time to deal with all of the issues, but I'm going to deal with this issue in particular, that the school is the command of God, and that that school, therefore, is necessary as the demand of God's covenant, so that the school institution, formed by parents, in which teachers are employed and is run by a board, that school institution is in fact commanded by God and is the demand of God's covenant. And I want to begin by reading just two passages of Scripture. I could read many more. I'm going to read two passages of Scripture. The first is in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Verses 50 through 58. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Then another passage from Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, and be in that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, But in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even to the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Those passages that I read, and many other passages in the sacred scripture, are about the school. And I want to make clear tonight, at the very beginning, that this speech is against homeschooling. Many of you have probably read Reverend Vanderwall's post on his blog. In that post on his blog, Reverend Vanderwall makes the case that the homeschool is a school. And he makes the case that the school, as an institution formed by parents for the purpose of educating their children, is not the demand of the covenant. Reverend Vanderwall, in that post, is presenting the Protestant Reform position on the school. The Protestant Reform churches in 2008 and 2009 gutted Article 21. They gutted Article 21, and they gutted the principal doctrinal basis of the good Christian school. And removing the principal doctrinal basis of the good Christian school, therefore they fatally injured the movement of the good Christian school. That position I opposed. I was at Synod 2008 and 2009, and I spoke against that position. I preached against that position. I gave speeches against that position, and I wrote against that position. I am opposed to everything that Reverend Vanderwall proposes in his blog post. The position that he takes in that blog post is diametrically opposed to the truth of the Scripture and of the Reformed creeds. It is diametrically opposed to what I believe, what I believe my entire life, what I've taught my entire ministry, and what I'm going to present to you tonight. The good Christian school as institution is the demand of God's covenant, and therefore also the movement for homeschooling is contrary to God's covenant. I am not opposed to a parent teaching his or her children schooling at home. I'm not opposed to that as an emergency measure. What I'm opposed to is the Christian school, the homeschool movement. The homeschool movement, which would give homeschooling an equal footing with the good Christian school, which would teach that the homeschool and the good Christian school are both the demand of God's covenant. I am opposed, indeed, I cannot exist in the same denomination and group of churches with the homeschooling movement. The homeschooling movement, in all of its principles, is opposed to the movement for the good Christian school. The homeschool, whatever the homeschool is not a school. A school is an organization formed by parents for the purpose of educating their children by qualified teachers. A homeschool is not that. And a homeschool is indeed opposed to that. Those two movements, The homeschool movement and the good Christian school movement cannot coexist in the same denomination. The homeschool movement comes with a plea for toleration. That plea for toleration was present at the recent classes. All we're asking for is that the homeschool movement be tolerated in the churches. That plea was also present in Reverend Vanderwall's blog. All we're pleading for is that the homeschool movement be given an equal footing, recognized as a legitimate form of schooling, along with the good Christian school. But I say to you, those two movements cannot coexist. The principles put forward for the good Christian school militate against the homeschool. And the principles put forward for the homeschool militate against the good Christian school. Toleration of homeschooling will not lead to coexistence. Toleration of homeschooling will lead to the destruction of the Christian school movement. And I want to make that clear tonight, that as much as I am promoting the good Christian school, I am opposed to homeschooling. Homeschooling is selfish, loveless, independent, and anti-covenantal. Just as the school is self-sacrificial, full of love, and flows out of God's covenant. And in our denomination, they cannot coexist. And I don't want anybody tonight to use the word school, for I'm going to speak of the school, to use that word school as an excuse to say, well, homeschooling really fits in the definition of a school. It is disingenuous on the part of the homeschooler to take the word school and to say that that word school really is the equivalent of the word education. A school is an institution. A school is an institution alongside of the church and of the home. That school as an institution flows out of the church and it flows out of the home. And that school as an institution is an expression of God's covenant. Furthermore, no one in the Reformed Protestant denomination ought to be surprised that there is a controversy in our churches about the school. Whenever there has been a reformation of the church, the schools have always been involved. And here, with regard to the specific doctrinal issue that resulted in the Reformed Protestant churches, the schools are a part of that. The specific doctrinal issue was the life of God's elect child in his covenant. Whether that life was a life of unconditional fellowship with God through Jesus Christ, and the school belongs to that life. Indeed, it is not at all an exaggeration to say that the life of God's covenant people revolve around the school. For 9 months out of the year, their entire life is geared to that school. The father wakes up in the morning to make money to pay for the school. The mother gets up in the morning to get her children prepared for the school. The children spend 8 hours of day at the school. They come home and they do schoolwork. They go to bed at a certain time because they have to get up for the school. The school is the life of the Reformed home. And we fought a controversy over that life, whether that life is a gracious gift from God to be enjoyed in Jesus Christ without any conditions. And the covenant, as that covenant comes to expression in the school, also then was reanimated by that recovery of the truth of the covenant. God wanted the school issue to come up so that that school issue could be faced again in light of a fresh appreciation, a fresh understanding of the doctrine of the covenant, that that life of the covenant is an unconditional gift of God. And so we have controversy with regard to the school. I welcome the controversy. That controversy was present with us from the very beginning. In the very beginning of our churches, almost as soon as we signed the act of separation, the issue of the school was present. The issue then was whether we were even going to have a school. There were those who said, we're going to keep using the Protestant Reformed schools, and those that can't can fend for themselves. It was a disgusting and loveless display that characterized the beginning of the churches. And when that issue was settled, that in fact we were going to have our own schools, then the controversy became, are those schools going to be denominational in character? There were those who did not want the schools associated with the churches at all. Keep the churches out of the schools was the hue and cry. But a parent who takes the vow of baptism to teach his children the aforesaid doctrine of the church that he goes to or she goes to has no other option but to send his child to a school that teaches them that doctrine. If they don't exist, they must form them. If they exist, they must use them. And when that issue was settled, then this controversy came into the foreground. And it reared its head again, and the controversy is this. What is the specific basis of the school? Why do you form them? Why do you maintain them? Why do you use them? Is the school merely demanded, if we would even use that word, demanded by practical considerations? By that I mean, is the school simply an extension of the reality and flows out of the reality that most parents cannot teach their kids in the school? So that homeschooling becomes the ideal. Really, if we all could homeschool, we should homeschool. Homeschooling is the best. And we really make a concession when we form the schools. The school then is the next best option. Is that the basis of the school? A mere practical reality. We can go on with that. The complicated nature of life means that there must be qualified teachers. And so we have to have a school. Is the basis merely practical? Or is the basis doctrinal? Is the basis rooted in an eternal and unchangeable principle? Which means that that basis is rooted in God Himself. The answer of the Reformed Protestant churches, and I believe the answer of the Reformed churches all through history, was that the school rests on an eternal and unchangeable principle. And that principle is the principle of God's covenant. That school rests on God's own nature as the covenant God. That school rests on God's establishment of a covenant of grace with us. The school rests on the covenant. And so really, the answer to the question of the command of the school is the covenant. The answer to the question of the necessity of the school is the covenant. The covenant, the covenant, the covenant. That is the basis, that is the demand, that is the necessity of the school. And I want to establish that from Scripture and the creeds, and I want to establish that, too, from church history. The doctrine of the Reformed Protestant churches on the schools is no new doctrine. It is the Reformed position all through history. Now we must understand that when we speak of the command and necessity of the good Christian school, by that word command, we mean God's command. God, in Jesus Christ, commands the Christian school. As God commands, do not commit adultery and do not steal, God commands the good Christian school. As God commands, go to church, and as God commands, get married, so God commands the good Christian school. When we say that the command for the good Christian school is from God, then we also free ourselves from the charge of legalism. Just as it is not legalistic for the church to preach, you may not have idols, you may not have images, you may not commit adultery, and you may not steal, so it is not legalism for the church to preach, you must have a good Christian school. That is not legalist because as we preach that you may not have idols and you may not have images and you may not commit adultery, you may not steal, as we preach that, not as the requirement for your salvation, the law is never a demand for salvation. Rather, the law is the guide of a thankful life. The law expresses what is written by the Holy Spirit upon the heart of the child of God. I don't have to have the preacher comes to me to tell me you should not have an idol so that I need to be informed of that in the first instance. I already have it written on my heart. That's already the delight of my heart. And when the preacher says, you can't have any idols, I say, yes. Yes, I love that law of God. That's the delight of my heart. So also with the school. God is a covenant God. Christ is a covenant Christ, and the Spirit is a covenant Spirit. And He writes God's covenant on our heart, the love of that covenant. And as part as writing that covenant on our heart, He writes the school on our heart. When the minister comes and says, you must have a good Christian school, I say, yes. Yes, that's the delight of my heart. Out of thankfulness for God's salvation of me, His promise to me and His children. On my heart I have written, form a good Christian school. So that we recognize that there is a command, but that command is no legalistic command. That command is simply the teaching of the Word of God, informing us of what God already wrote on our hearts by His Holy Spirit. And when we speak of the necessity of the good Christian school, then we mean two things. First of all, we mean the obedience of covenant parents to God's command to form a good Christian school. The necessity of the school is the demand of God's covenant. God said, form a school, and therefore that's the necessity of the school. God established a relationship of fellowship and friendship with us. God incorporated us and our children into that covenant. And as part of our life with God and of one another in the covenant, God commands and we obey to form good Christian schools. That necessity of the good Christian school also includes the practical necessity of the covenant. What I mean by that is that the task of rearing the covenant child is the central work in the life of the covenant parent. And that task of raising the covenant child is what the covenant parent swore before God and the church to do. So that the covenant parent, when that covenant parent took his child or her child for baptism, said, I will teach them in the aforesaid doctrine, or help or cause them to be instructed therein to the utmost of my power. And the parent took that before the entire congregation, so that the entire congregation is taken up into that vow.
The entire congregation now is obligated. They are obligated by virtue of having witnessed that vow to help that parent. They must do it. It is lovelessness. It is cruelty. It is disobedience. It's hatred. For those parents and members of the congregation who saw the parent take that vow, who nodded their heads at that vow, in a figurative way, and who, when they watched the parent take that vow, were saying, "We'll help you." And then when it comes to the school, they say, "Except for that." That task of raising the child is an all-consuming task. That task takes phenomenal resources, not only of money, but of time and of talent and of information. The child has to be taught to be a friend and servant of God in this world that we live in. And this world develops and this world increases in complication, that to teach those children all that they need to know to live in this world, that takes the entire church. And out of that practical necessity, and the fact that the church said, "We'll help you," that the baptism form demands the school. You can't read the baptism form any other way. The baptism form isn't an individual coming up before an empty church. It's an individual coming or a family coming before the entire congregation. And that individual there swearing to teach their children. And the whole congregation saying, "We'll help you." That's the necessity of the school. That's the demand of the school. And then, also in that practical necessity of the school, there is the very idea of the covenant itself. The covenant is life together. Simply what it is. We in common are partakers of Jesus Christ. Being partakers of Jesus Christ, we are his body and we have fellowship one with another. And that covenant is life together. And our children belong to that covenant. They must have a life together. They must have a life together as children of the church. If one is off homeschooling his children over there, and one is off homeschooling his children over there, and one is off homeschooling his children over there, they don't have a life together. They're not together. The homeschooling parent separates his children from the other children. He separates his children from the church and fellowship with the other children of the church. And those parents, by doing that, have taught their children, "You don't need the church. You can be separate from the church for 6 days out of the week." And those children develop no practical relationships with their fellows. Why do you think God wants his children together as children? They're learning. They're not learning math and science and Bible. They're learning how to be together as children. The homeschooling parent takes them away from the other children of the church. And they don't develop those relationships, and so those children have no strong relationship with the church. And those parents that do that then have the temerity to complain. "Well, our children don't have any friends in church." Well, no kidding. They don't see each other for 6 days out of the week. What do you expect? I say the very idea of the covenant, of togetherness, not now as parents, but as children, demands the school. And so that school then is an exercise in love. That school is an exercise in love on the part of the whole church. The church that saw the parents take the vow at baptism in love for those parents and in love for those children, recognizing that the parents are not going to be able to teach their children by themselves, they band together to form a school . Where would be the love of a congregation who sees a mother come up who is utterly incapable of schooling her children, and they watch her take the vow, and they know she cannot teach them math and science and writing? They know that. And they watch her take the vow, and they say, yes, we'll help you. And they leave her to fend for herself. We're going to homeschool our kids because we know how to do that. We're going to homeschool our kids because we're capable of doing that. And you, well, you can't, and we're sorry about that, but you better fend for yourself. Where's the love in that? There's no love in that. Where's the love of the church for the mother of 9 children who comes with her 10th to the front of church and has the child baptized and promises to teach that child like she did all the other 9, the truth of God's scripture as it applies to all the area of life, and the church nods their head, we'll help you, and they don't help her at all. Where's the love in that? She can't teach all those kids. There is no love in that. It's loveless. It's selfish. It's anti-covenantal. And it's love for the children that you see those children as needing the other children of the church, needing to be with them, needing to play with them, to learn with them. And in love for that need, you form the good Christian school. And so to anybody who says, there's no demand in Scripture for the good Christian school, what they're saying is, there's no verse in the Bible that says, thou shalt form a good Christian school. And when they say that, they take me for a fool. There are many things in the Christian life where there's no verse in the Bible that says thou shalt or thou shalt not, and yet it's a demand. The demand of the good Christian school is everywhere that Scripture teaches the covenant. If you sit down and think through the covenant for 5 minutes, you will say, well, yes, of course we need a good Christian school. Our children need to be together. The covenant demands it. Everywhere Scripture teaches the communion of the saints, all the parents get to have communion, but the children don't. If you think through the communion of the saints for 5 seconds and you apply it to the children, you will see that the school is demanded. They have to be together. The baptism form demands the school. He doesn't say it, thou shalt have a school. But those parents stand up in front of the congregation and they take the vow, help or cause them to be instructed. The whole congregation says yes to that. That demands the good Christian school. Everywhere the Scripture teaches love, love doesn't look on its own things. Love could never say this. I'm going to teach my kids, and you can fend for yourself. That's a loveless hate-filled statement. That statement is an attack on God, an attack on the covenant, and an attack on the church itself. Love couldn't say that. Scripture tells us what love's attitude is. Love does not look on its own things only, but love looks on the things of others. That's the mind of Christ. How do you know someone has the mind of Christ? They don't only look on their own things, they look on the things of others. And apply that to the school. You don't only look on the things for the education of your own children. You look on the things for the education of all the church's children. That's love. That's the mind of Christ. Love, according to the book of Acts, has all things in common. The early church was one in doctrine. They had one mind and they had one table. And they had all things in common. And that wasn't teaching communism among the church. They all had their own individual possessions. But they so looked on the things of others that their things were the things of everybody else in the church. Apply that to the school once. It is as much an obligation for the church, for the families of the church, to educate one family's children as another family's children. We have all things in common. Also, the education of our children. We would even say especially the education of our children. Of all of the consuming activities in the life of the child of God, that has to be central. The Reformed parent expends himself or herself for the education of their children, and that in particular we must have in common. And besides all those things, there are those passages in Scripture that speak to Israel as a nation and address the fathers of that nation as the heads of home and tell them, teach the children. We don't need those passages to establish the school. You can establish the school without them. You can establish school on the basis of Scripture's teaching on the covenant, Scripture's teaching on baptism, Scripture's teaching on love. You can establish the school as a demand of God's covenant. But then you have all those passages that God says to the fathers of the nation, teach the children. And he obligates the entire nation in the task of educating the nation's children. And there are those who say, well, that only refers to the fathers themselves. I would say that interpretation reveals the anti-covenantal mindset of the person who says it. Even if those passages are addressing an individual father, it addresses that individual father as he's part of God's covenant. So that the calling of that individual father has to be interpreted in light of the entire covenant of God. Scripture teaches in multiple ways the school institution as the demand of God's covenant. And because Scripture teaches it, the Reformed creeds teach the same thing. In the Reformed creeds, first of all, there is the explicit black on white mention of the word school. That word is not up for grabs. It is a school. It's not a seminary school. It's a grade school or a high school. Primary or secondary education. That's how the actual author of the Heidelberg Catechism interpreted the term. A school. And that demand for the school is included in Lord's Day 38. That's not a position that came about by happenstance, that they said, oh, we haven't mentioned the school yet in 37 Lord's Days, we better get a mention in. That's where the subject of the school belongs. That's where the subject of the demand for the school belongs. Because, first of all, in that section, we're teaching the law. We're teaching about God's demands upon his people whom he's redeemed. And one of those demands is the school. And that comes up, secondly, in the context of Lord's Day 38, because Lord's Day 38 is about the covenant. You could simply preach a sermon on Lord's Day 38 entitled, The Covenant. That's the theme of the Lord's Day. That's because the theme of the Lord's Day is God's rest. God in himself is a God of rest as the covenant God. As the covenant God, God has decreed to give rest to his people, rest from all their sins, rest from condemnation, rest from the dominion of sin and the devil, rest with God in covenant fellowship with him. And God gives his people rest. And in that commandment, God says always this, enter into my rest. For 6 days a week, we enter into God's rest. We live out of, by faith, the finished and completed work of Christ. We live out of that as one body. And on Sunday, we come together as the body of Jesus Christ to worship God and enter into the rest through the preaching of the gospel. And the school is simply the entering into the rest of the children. God is, as it were, saying in Lord's Day 38, and the Reformed fathers were saying when they put schools in Lord's Day 38, give your children rest. Let them enjoy God's covenant. Let them fellowship together as fellow members of the church. Let them learn together. Give them rest. That's why it's in Lord's Day 38. That's a logical place for God to teach the demand of the school as the demand of his covenant. And the school is also by implication in Lord's Day 21. We are all members of Christ. And with that statement, they are saying, we are one body with Jesus Christ. We have all things in common in Jesus Christ. And that includes the education of our children. It's not mentioned explicitly, but it's there. Can you imagine a builder is going to build a house? That's a complicated task. That's an all-consuming task for him. And that builder says, well, I can build the house myself. Now, technically, that might be true. Maybe he can. Maybe he's got that system figured out. He doesn't need any help. He can do it all by himself. The building of a house is a task that requires cooperation. The very nature of the task does. You need a framer. You need an installer. You need a finished carpenter. You need people to hold things while you nail and screw them together. That's a huge task. And so is the raising of our covenant children. It is an enormous task. The very nature of the task requires cooperation. Mutual goodwill, mutual support, sharing of resources. Lord's Day 28, when it mentions the communion of the saints, that we're all one body, by implication demands the school. And the baptism form. The baptism form, as I said, that requires the parents to take their vow before the entire church, never mentions the school explicitly, but it demands the school. The entire church now is involved in the raising of those covenant seed. And it's because Scripture and the Reformed creeds teach the school as the demand of the covenant that the Reformed faith put schools in the church order as the demand of God's covenant. They believe what Scripture and the creed say. Then that article, Article 21, where it's mentioned, that article has always been the object of the loathing of those who hate good Christian schools. They want that article gone. Because that article makes explicit the school as demand of the covenant. If English words have any meaning, that's what the article is teaching, the school as the demand of the covenant. And the Reform simply, without any shame, without any hesitation, put that into the church order so that the elders would see to it. Such is it an important task that the elders must see to that good Christian school. And the Reform then, all through history, had that view. And I want to establish that tonight. The view of the Reformed Protestant churches is not something new. The emphasis of the Reformed Protestant churches upon the schools is not something new. This is Reformed, we would even say reformational. It's true that there's always been development in the doctrine of the schools. All through history, there's been development in the doctrine of the schools. During the time of the Reformation, with its recovery of the gospel, not only reanimated the church, but reanimated the schools. And that Reformation cause of the schools was taken up enthusiastically by the Reformed. And the Reformed, already at Dort, talked about the consistory seeing to it that there were good Christian schoolmasters who would teach in the state-run schools the children, all of the Reformed faith. They took up that demand of God's covenant for the education of the children. And they didn't see clearly all of the issues involved with the schools. That had to come through controversy. There was always controversy over the schools. The Reformed used those state schools in the Netherlands for years. And when the offskiding came, then they had to re-examine the schools again. And they saw that those schools should not be formed by the government, but should be formed by the church. And they connected those schools to the church and to God's covenant tightly. And they said really this, let there be a school formed by the church and let it teach the truth of the church. And then later on, when the Doleancy came with Abraham Kuyper, they saw and realize that the school is not the work of the church institute, but that school is to be the work of parents who formed that school. And another advance was made in the doctrine of the schools. And then again, in this country, when the Christian Reformed Church was formed, they saw the importance of the school, that so important was it that you could split the church over it. It wasn't a matter that could be allowed to be in the church either or. You could split the church over it. You could split the church over it because it involved God's covenant. There's no more important doctrinal issue than the covenant of God and the church. And although the Christian Reformed Church did not mention the school explicitly in its act of separation from the Reformed Church in America, it was the undercurrent. And as a Christian Reformed minister, Herman Hoeksema split his congregation. It was over the school. He preached and preached and preached the school until they choked on it. And they left. And over half his congregation left over the matter of the school. That was an advance in the doctrine of the school. So important is it that when that school is opposed, when that school is threatened, you stand and you fight for that school, even to the division of the church. And so also in the Protestant Reformed churches of Herman Hoeksema, there was an advance through their struggle for the school. It's shocking to me And it will remain shocking to me that in the Protestant Reformed churches it took so long to get Protestant Reformed schools. That was because there had to be an issue that was clarified. There had to be controversy over those schools. Those Protestant Reformed parents were using the Christian Reformed school, the existing Christian Reformed schools, just like Reformed Protestant parents wanted to use Protestant Reformed schools. That was happening. That happened for years, decades. And that instruction in the Christian Reformed schools was wrecking the church. You had a whole generation of children who were taught Christian Reformed doctrine, and that affected them. They were together with Christian Reformed children 5 days out of the week. They didn't see any reason to be separate from them for one day out of the week. That was wrecking the churches, and that would have happened in the Reformed Protestant churches too. If we continued to use Protestant Reformed schools, it was gracious of God that they threw us out the door, because we would have stayed. And the very same thing would have happened to us as happened to the Protestant Reformed churches. The use of those schools would have wrecked the churches. 1953 was the result not only of the infiltration of false doctrine into the Protestant Reformed churches, but it was the result of using Christian Reformed schools for decades. And that brought up an advance in the doctrine of the schools. The parents were forced to reckon with the reality of their baptism vow. In the Netherlands, there was never any other option. You used the state schools, and then you used the Offscheiding schools, and then you used the Doleantse school. There was no other option. In the States, there was an option. Do we form Protestant Reformed schools, or do we stay with the existing Christian schools? And that forced the parents to reckon with the fact of what their vow was. We vow to teach them the aforesaid doctrine. That's the doctrine of this Christian church. That's not a generally Reformed doctrine. That's the doctrine of this Christian church. That's the doctrine that comes off the pulpit that I hear every week and that demanded a denominational school. I would say in light of our vows, it is entire, even if we could, it would be entirely illegitimate for us to use the Protestant Reformed schools, the Christian Reformed schools, or the Reformed schools. It's entirely improper. Our vow won't let us. We're going to teach them the aforesaid doctrine. Now, you can't put them in a school for 5 days out of the week where they don't learn that. In the public school, they learn the world's doctrine. They have a doctrine. They're being taught something, but it's the world. And in the apostate Christian schools, they're being taught apostate Christianity. And that was an advance. Always the Reformed had to face the issue of the school. Always there was controversy of the school, and always there was an advance in the schools. This wasn't any new doctrine that we had to fight now about the schools, that we had to ask about what is the specific doctrinal basis of the school. That is a gracious gift of God to us, that we can have this controversy so that they can be established, so that we can be one together on this issue. If someone doesn't believe that the school is the demand of the covenant, just leave. Leave. But I'm never going to stop preaching it. If your church does not believe that the school is the demand of the covenant and you ask me to come preach for you, you're getting two sermons. The school has the demand of the covenant, and the school has the demand of the covenant too. And you're going to get those sermons until you either throw me off the pulpit or you start a school. We must be one on this. And this insistence that the school is the demand of the covenant isn't new. It isn't new in my own ministry. No one ever should be surprised that when Reverend Langerak became a Reformed Protestant minister, that he preaches the schools. You can't be surprised at that. This isn't the first speech that I gave on the schools. This isn't the first speech that I gave in Northwest Iowa on the schools. In 2009, I spoke to the then High School Association in Northwest Iowa. The subject of my speech was the school as the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. My text was 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. The risen Lord Jesus Christ has only one work. The risen Lord Jesus Christ's work is the perfection of his covenant. The perfection of his covenant, which is the bringing of the kingdom of God, so that God be all in all. And I said this, and I'm going to quote what I preached in 2009 in Iowa about the schools. I said this, quote, related to these two great aspects of the work of the Lord in the church and home is the work of the organic life of the church in the schools. The institution of grade and high schools run by school associations through their duly elected boards and filled with hired teachers and students are not the church, and they are not the home. Yet that institution is intimately connected with both. They are a part of the threefold cord of church, home, and school that is not easily broken. To the church, it is connected as a work of the organic life of the church, growing out of the church's belief in the covenant with us and with our children, and demanding a specifically Christian and distinctly Reformed education in obedience to the command of God and the oath of baptism to instruct these children in the aforesaid doctrine. I preached that in 2009. It is the labor of the church, inasmuch as the church's children that are being instructed, and the baptism form gives not only to the parents, but also the very questions themselves, gives the church institute a vested interest in what and in how her children are educated. As an old Reformed consistory stated, quote, our Christian schools are the feeders of our Christian churches, end quote. They consider that axiomatic. Where the schools prosper, so does the Church of Jesus Christ. He sees to it, for it is his work. And to the home, the schools are connected as the necessary means whereby parents carry out their God-given right to instruct their children through doctrinally steadfast and doctrinally unmovable teachers who function in those schools in the place of parents, teach those children what the parents themselves would teach them. The place of parents, the teachers give those children an education in every subject from PE to Bible on the basis of the truth that the parents who formed those schools and hired those teachers believe to be the truth of the Word of God. We must not take it for granted that the work of education in the schools is viewed by all as the work of the Lord in his covenant and kingdom. There was a threat. There always is a threat to the Christian school by those who want to rip away the school from its foundation, the covenant, and the kingdom. Christian education is an application of the text. That work means by the risen Christ, who has only one great, grand, and glorious work. That work fundamentally is Christ's labor to perfect his covenant and kingdom to the glory of God. Christ is Lord of all, yet all his labors aim at this goal. There is no other work of Jesus Christ. This includes the work of the church institute and the home. Because the school is related to both, the labors of the schools are the work of the Lord for his covenant, church, and kingdom. The schools are the work of the risen and exalted Christ. They are the work of the risen and exalted Christ in his covenant and kingdom. The labor in the Christian schools is his work entirely. It is his work in the sense that he gave those schools as gifts. It is his work in the sense that in those schools and by means of those schools, the risen Lord Jesus Christ carries out his work, causing the coming of his kingdom, increasing and building up his covenant and strengthening his church. Then this, if parents, teachers, and churches are not convinced that the Christian school is the work of the Lord and the work of the Lord for his covenant, then they have fatally compromised the Lord's work in the school. They undermine, by their doubts, the efforts and sacrifices of the association for the existence and support of those schools, the work and decisions of the boards who run those schools, and the labors and teachers who teach in those schools. They even undermine the zealousness and attitude of the students themselves in their studies. If one does not believe that those schools are the work of the Lord in the interest of his covenant, kingdom, and church, then one cannot abound in that work. And in fact, he does not even have the right to engage in that work. If the school is not the demand of the covenant, if the school is not the work of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, you may not even engage in that work. Because he only has one work. That's the work of his covenant. It's exactly because the school is the work of the risen Lord Jesus Christ for his covenant. It's exactly because the school is the demand of the covenant that we engage in it. That's what the Reformed Fathers believed. That was clear by their decisions. They told their ministers to preach it. You can't tell a minister to preach something that's not the Word of God. That's wickedness. Ministers don't bring their opinions. They bring the Word of God. And when the Reformed consistory said to the ministers, preach the school, they might not have said it's the demand of the covenant, but they were saying that. When they demand that it be preached, when the Reformed Fathers gave to the consistories the mandate to see to it, they were teaching that that school is the demand of the covenant. When Christian parents engage in the school with all of their blood, sweat, and tears, they don't do that for practical reasons. They're Reformed. Reformed men and women live out of only one thing. That's God's covenant. And that conviction expressed itself in the Reformers. I can prove that. A church historian, Philip Schaff, states in his 8-volume work on the Reformation and church history, quote, education, by which he meant schools, education and the advance of true religion are inseparable. End quote. And again, quote, church and school go together. End quote. And again, quote, the Reformation gave a powerful impulse to common schools. The Reformation was as much about the church as it was the school. Then there's church historian Merle Daubigny, when he says, quote, it was not the public worship alone that the Reformation was ordained to change. The school was early placed beside the church, and these two great institutions were equally reanimated by it. You want to know why we're talking about the school? Because we just had a controversy about the doctrine of the covenant. The church was reanimated by that. And the school was reanimated by that. In 2008 and 9, the Protestant Reformed churches killed the schools. They killed them. They're dying a slow death, and they will. Because it's not God's covenant. They fill those schools with their lies and their filth. The school had to be reanimated. We had to be filled again with the conviction that the school is the demand of the covenant, so that we zealously engage in that labor, and so that we oppose all that's opposed to it. That's what the gospel does. All the major reformers wrote a treatise on the schools. Luther wrote two. Melanchthon wrote so many textbooks for the schools that he was simply called the schoolmaster. Zwingli, Ulrich Zwingli, wrote two treatises on Christian education. From Luther, we read this. Quote, because they're not willing to support and keep the honest, upright, virtuous schoolmasters and teachers offered to them by God to raise their children in the fear of God and in virtue, knowledge, learning, and honor by dint of hard work, diligence, and industry, and at small cost and expense, they will get in their place incompetent substitutes, ignorant louts, such as they have had before, who are a great cost and expense, will teach the children nothing but how to be utter asses and beyond, to dishonor their wives and daughters and maidservants, taking over their homes and property as has happened before. This will be the reward of the great and shameful ingratitude into which the devil is so craftily leading them. They wouldn't start schools. And Luther clubbed them. And he laid his finger, too, on one of the reasons why there's resistance to the schools. Luther, if nothing else, was shrewd. They won't bear the cost. Sometimes the opposition to the school is that vulgar. It's simply a dollar. They won't pay for the school. Sometimes the opposition to the school is vulgar in another sense. The school doesn't have the right program. The school involves sacrifices for my brilliant student who has to sit with idiots. And they teach their children no love for the school either. The opposition is carnal and vulgar, and Luther laid his finger on that. And Luther went after the nobles. They were the ones who had the money to start the school. You would say today, you went after the rich men. The rich men who had the money to start the schools, and they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't put their necks to the labor. And Luther went after them. We admit, you say, there should and must be schools, but what is the use of teaching Latin, Greek, and Hebrew and other liberal arts? Could we not teach in German the Bible and God's Word, which are sufficient for salvation? Yes, I answer, I know well, alas, that we Germans must ever be and abide brute and wild beasts, as the surrounding nations call us. The arts and languages, which do us no harm, nay, which are a greater ornament, benefit, honor, and advantage, both for understanding holy writ and for managing civil affairs, we are disposed to despair, and foreign wares, which are neither necessary nor useful, and which, moreover, peel us to the very bone, these are not willing to forego. Those nobles wanted to spend their money on everything else but the school. And Luther again then laid his finger on one of the points of opposition. It's as vulgar as a dollar. They simply don't value education. They don't see it as necessary. And that Reformation insistence was taken up by the Dutch. H. Bauman, a church order commentary during the time of Abraham Kuyper's Doleantie, wrote in his church order commentary in Dutch this, quote, initially the fight was only for the Christian school, that is, the school with the Bible. But through force of circumstances, the question of the independent free school comes up. With the development of the controversy, it was necessary that the Christian schools be established and maintained by associations. The rule ought to be that the school comes from the parents, according to the ordinance of God's covenant. There he lays his finger on it. The full task of rearing children rests first of all with the parents. It follows from this that the school must stand on the self-same foundation as the Christian home, that is to say, on the basis of the covenant. Bauman was simply teaching, when he mentions controversy, when the Reformed Church came into existence in the Netherlands, there was immediately controversy about the schools. What are these schools going to be? And he says, through that controversy, we came to understand not only that there had to be schools, but those schools had to be started by parents, and those schools had to stand on the foundation of God's covenant. And a similar thing happened in the United States in the Christian Reformed Church. The Christian Reformed Church came out of the Reformed Church in America. And the Christian Reformed Church was started by men who had left the Netherlands because their ability to form Christian schools had been hampered. They wrote this, quote, they wanted freedom. That is, those men who came from the Netherlands, they wanted freedom to establish their own Christian schools and, quote, to enjoy the great privilege of having their children taught in Christian schools. That's what they wanted. That's why they came. That's why the Christian Reformed Church separated and started. And if you read the early acts of the synods and classes of the Christian Reformed Church from 1870, maybe a little earlier, but 1870, all the way to 1936, they are full of references to the schools. For instance, 1870, the Christian Reformed Church says this, quote, the schools are the nursery of the church. In 1873, they said, quote, they obligated consistories to establish free Christian schools. They obligated them. You must do this. And what was the source of that obligation? The source of every obligation in the life of the child of God. The covenant. So the baptism form teaches that God's covenant obliges you to new obedience. And they use that language with regard to the school. Then again, they insisted that the congregations take steps to bring such schools into being, end quote. In 1892, again, they advocated the establishment of school societies. In 1898, quote, the General Synod declares Christian education, according to Reformed principles, is the incontrovertible duty of Reformed Christians. And Christian education there, you understand, they meant school. It's the incontrovertible duty. And they warned all ministers and elders are to work for the cause of Christian education in every place where such is at all possible. Then they grounded that. Why are we telling the churches, start schools? One, God's word demands that our children be trained in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Two, the promise of the parents at the time of baptism. Three, there may be no separation between civic, social, or religious life, education, and training. Four, the honor of our King demands it, since all power is given him in heaven and earth, also in the realm of education and all knowledge. Is that any different from what we're saying? Isn't any different at all? That was the position of the Christian Reformed Church way back in 1898. And it was under those convictions that the Christian Reformed Church, without any hesitation, changed the wording of Article 21 to read that consistory shall see to it that there are good Christian schools established according to the demands of the covenant. And then later on, this is still in 1936, the CRC Synod was addressed by a church, one of the classes, who asked about the questions of Article 41. Those questions of Article 41 were the origin of the suspension and deposition of two office bearers from sovereign. That's how the matter came to classes. That was perfectly legitimate. And that the meaning of those questions was before the Synod of the Christian Reformed Church in 1936. What does that question mean about the consistory supporting the good Christian school? And they said, quote, schools in Article 41 refer to the Christian primary grammar in high schools, not home schools. That's the ploy of many. They want to take all of this history. They want to take every reference to Christian education and school and say, well, that applies to a homeschool. The Christian Reformed Church defines it. Grammar in high schools. Schools. And then they said the expression support means the duty of the consistory to use every proper means to the end that a Christian school may be established where it does not exist. And that Article 21, they must give wholehearted and unreserved moral backing to the existing Christian schools and a measure of financial help in case of need. And then, in response to the question, what should we do with a consistory that won't do that? They said, admonish them to repent. It was a matter of repentance when you don't support the good Christian school. Repentance! You're anti-covenantal, you're full of hatred toward your neighbor, you're an independent, you're selfish and loveless. Repent! That was the Reformed position. That was the Reformed position from the beginning. The school, as an institution, is the command of God, is necessary as the demand of God's covenant. And that's what you must understand from the speech tonight. The necessity of the Christian school, the demand of the Christian school, the command of the Christian school, the basis of the Christian school is the covenant, the covenant, the covenant, the covenant. I thank you. We're going to take a little break while we gather up questions that I'm going to attempt to answer. Maybe 5 minutes or so, then we'll come back in here. Let's close in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we rejoice before thee as our covenant God. We thank thee for the opportunity tonight to address the matter of the school, which is a part of thy covenant and therefore dear unto thee, so that thou art not indifferent to the Christian school, but thou dost call thy people to form them, to use them, to maintain them. That as the work of the risen Lord Jesus Christ on behalf of his covenant. Use the speech, Lord, to fight against lies and opposition. And use the speech to encourage thy people that we might put our necks to the work of the good Christian schools. We pray, Lord, for the pardon of our sins. Send us away with thy blessing, we ask all these things for Jesus' sake. Amen.